portrait, the glory of the gallery. Brilliant brushwork builds and becomes a beautiful image, made in the image of beauty. But though it is so very lifelike, it is also lifeless, with eyes that let no sunlight in, ears that never hear the sweetness of the symphony, a mouth that cannot kiss or sing or taste. Some days we cannot help but wonder, will it always be this way? Are we to be confined behind this gilded cage as reality passes by? But then we remember, the great artist himself has loved us into life. Now, his breath in our lungs, we bear witness to what he will do next. Now, with eyes unveiled, we see the meaning behind the material, in the minutiae of wheat, weeds, and mustard seeds. Our hands, caked with mud, made of mud, sift through farmers' fields and feel, firm and sure, the promise of pearls. And our listening ears hear a voice, promising that there is more, that one day we will meet the one who painted us, who etched us in earth and breathed life in our blood, who shouldered our sin and bought life with his blood. One day we will see him. One day we will see.
Last week, Jesus told a story about dirt. Next week, weeds. Week after that, we'll get a nice little story about seeds, yeast, pearls, hidden treasure, and fish. Seven short little stories, all each of them found in this chapter. All of them at first glance seem to be somewhat random and maybe a little bit elementary for our tastes. This sort of seems like Sunday school kind of stuff, you know. Parable of the sower and things like that that pair well with a cartoon drawing. Jesus is changing teaching styles here between chapter 13 and what we've seen previously. And the teaching style that he's using here in the form of parables has happened so drastically, okay, it's such a sharp change, and it's happened so abruptly that even Jesus' disciples have noticed. They say to him in verse 10, why are you speaking to these people in parables? They want to know why. So it's clear to them at this point that there's more to the parable that he just told than what meets the eye, because he said in verse 9, after he told the parable, that anyone with ears to hear ought to hear. That suggests that there's a deeper meaning there. And so they recognize that, but why is he being so vague? They don't know. And I suppose the answers are swirling around in their minds as to why Jesus is doing this. It's caught their attention, that's for sure. Is Jesus losing steam? Is he getting tired out? Is he just giving up? Is he feeling the pressure from the masses, and is he become a coward? Because things have certainly changed, and I think that the disciples at this point are sort of indicating that they maybe preferred his former method of teaching. Certainly was a little more exciting. That clear and bold and controversial style of preaching that made people marvel when they heard it. That's what Mark 12, 17 says. That's what we find in Luke chapter 4, verse 22. It left people astonished when they heard Jesus preaching the things that he was preaching. We saw that in Matthew chapter 7, verse 28, and Mark chapter 6, verse 2. In fact, the word astonished is used 13 times in the New Testament, 12 in reference to Jesus, and 10 of those 12 in specific regard to his teaching, how people were reacting to the way he taught. They were astonished. And the word itself means shocked. Nobody's shocked when he talks about dirt. But they were when he said some of the things that he had previously said. It means shocked. It means stricken with panic. People had been hearing his teaching and stricken with panic, like fear. The idea in the definition of that term means to be left with your mouth gaping. Like you just took the ice water challenge. You know the ice bucket challenge that they used to do? You're left going, oh. Did you hear that? Did you hear what he just said? So people have been being dumbfounded up until now when they heard him teach. And Mark chapter 1, verse 22 tells us why they were so shocked. And it says that they were astonished because Jesus taught as one with authority, not like the scribes and the Pharisees. Jesus taught with great authority. So that set him apart from all the other boring, law-driven Pharisees that they had grown accustomed to. All the guys that were really milquetoast by comparison. When you heard Jesus, boy, you get a taste for that. You don't want to go back to that whatever pabulum it was that you were listening to before. Jesus had it. And now, suddenly, that authority seems to have vanished. All of the excitement is drained out of his teaching style. He went from, you've heard it said of old, but I'm telling you. You've heard other people say, you have your traditions, you know what's being said out there, but I'm telling you. He said stuff like, if your eye makes you sin, get a fork, dig it out. If your hand makes you sin, get a saw, cut it off. Be better for you to go into heaven with one hand or into heaven with one eye than into hell with both. He said stuff like, woe to you and this wicked generation. He said stuff like, if you're not with me, you're against me. Do you understand? He said stuff like, on judgment day, I'm going to be there denying many of you. These are the kinds of things he used to say. And he went from all of that to, seeds don't grow very well if they don't have right soil. So what has happened? The disciples were expecting a king. The Jews were expecting a king. The disciples were expecting Jesus to act like a king to convince the rest of the Jewish people who weren't yet convinced. They were waiting for a revolt. Okay, but this kind of stuff, parables, you know, Sunday school lessons, this isn't necessarily how a king flexes his muscle. At least that's what they would have thought. This isn't how a revolution is won, let alone begun. So Jesus now seems to, at first glance, have no more authority now than the average scribe. The excitement is gone. The wow factor is gone. There's nothing really left. And so the disciples are asking Jesus about it, and that's a good place to start. When you lack wisdom, you have options. Where do you go when you don't have an understanding of things? They had enough sense to go to Christ. So they go to Jesus and say, why are you doing this? We have questions for you. The big one is why? James tells us in chapter 1, verse 5, that if any of you lacks wisdom, so like if there's anybody here, this is an open invitation. If anybody here lacks wisdom, all you need to do is ask God. That's what you should do. So James says, you should ask God, because God gives generously to everybody without finding fault. He's not going to fault you for being stupid, for not having answers, and you're like, what, you don't know? He doesn't ridicule, he doesn't criticize, he doesn't belittle. You can go to God asking for wisdom, and he'll give it to you. Are you in the dark this morning? Like Jesus is doing stuff in your life, but you don't have an idea as to what it would be? Well, then where are you going for your answers? I certainly hope you'd come to Christ and you'd say, I need help with this. Can you please explain? I'm willing to wait. I'm willing to give you the time that you need to explain this and make this clear to me, but I will not go to any other source until I get my answers from you. And there's so many options. I already told you that. You could go to the world. You can go to philosophy. You can go to a number of different religions. Okay? You can even try borrowing the Christian religion as if religion in and of itself was able to provide you with answers. But if you dig, you'll find that it doesn't. You get busy with all your, you know, your take communion and get baptized and I'm doing all this and still you're in the dark. And the reason is because you've gone to baptism for answers or you've gone to communion for answers or you've gone to Buddha for answers, you've gone to yoga for answers, you've gone to the world for answers, you've gone to work, your career, you've gone to education. There's a host of things that people are going to look for answers in life and they're not getting them because it isn't Christ. They go to Jesus, and it's a beautiful illustration of what James told us. You lack wisdom? Then go and ask for it. Ask God. He'll give it to you. So the disciples are in the dark here, and so they come to Jesus for answers. That's where our text begins this morning. And now Jesus is going to tell them the story behind the stories. What's the reason for these parables? Jesus will explain. Let's pray. Father, as we come before you this morning, I pray that the message that you have to impart to me and us would be clear. You always have something to say, and if we come seeking answers, you are more than willing to provide them. So on behalf of myself and everybody present and anyone else that might be listening, I ask that you would give us the wisdom that James promised we could ask for, that it might be given. Help us to understand the reason for the story behind the stories. Amen. So the disciples come and they say to Jesus, why do you speak to them in parables? They're obviously a little bit confused here. And Jesus says, because it's been given to you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. That's why. Because it's been given to you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. But to them it is not them, you, not them. For whoever has, to him more will be given, and he will have abundance. But whoever doesn't have, even what he has is going to be taken away from him, Jesus says. That's why I speak to them in parables, because seeing, they don't see. And hearing, they don't hear. And they don't understand. That's the reason why I'm speaking to them in parables. It's been given to you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, not them. So obviously, the reason that he's speaking in parables, it has something to do with the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. Okay. I want you to notice as we go on in the next couple of weeks, every time he starts a parable, he says the kingdom of heaven is like. So he's explaining, he's giving in parabolic form little snippets of what the kingdom of heaven is like. Verse 24, verse 31, the kingdom of heaven is like. Another parable he put forth, the kingdom of heaven is like. Verse 33, the kingdom of heaven is like. Again, verse 44, again, the kingdom of heaven is like. Verse 45, again, the kingdom of heaven is like. Verse 47, again, the kingdom of heaven is like. And so he just is bringing to bear upon the minds and the understanding of the disciples what the kingdom of heaven is like. They're being given the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. So this morning, I want to help you understand what exactly are the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. What is this mystery? Okay, now pay close attention. This is a little bit intellectual, kinda. I'm not going to go real crazy on you. But based on Old Testament prophecy, it was no secret to the Jewish people that they were awaiting a Messiah, that there would one day come a Messiah. There was all kinds of prophecies where he would be born, you know, kind of how it would happen, the details surrounding it, lots of prophecies about this. It was well understood that a Messiah king would come. They were waiting for a savior to save them. They were waiting for a deliverer to deliver them, a conqueror to vanquish their foe, right? And they knew that it would be this savior king upon whose shoulders the government would rest, right? So they're looking for this kind of like political guy to show up as a king and set up his kingdom. They knew that he would set up an earthly kingdom. But what wasn't clear to the Jews in that day was that there would actually be two different arrivals of this king. There would be the first one. We call it Advent, and it's very timely because Christmas is the first Advent. As we celebrate, I don't know, some of you guys, if you didn't grow up in the church, that's a crazy church word, Advent. It just means arrival. So Christmas celebrates the arrival of Christ the first time. The first time Christ came into this world. But they didn't know that he was going to go away for a long time and then come back a second time. They didn't know Christ was supposed to return, not like this. They didn't know that there was going to be this in-between period of some unspecified amount of time. It wasn't clear to them that God intended there to be an interim period known as what we would call the last days. Of course, the New Testament does speak of the last days, and lucky for us, we do have that mystery revealed, but they didn't. It's really the church age, and it's the age in which we live in. And so it was a secret to them or a mystery to them, but it certainly isn't to us. We're waiting around for Jesus to come back, aren't we? We know he came once, baby born in a manger. We know he's coming a second time. We don't know when, but we do know he's coming back on a white horse, right? Flames, sword, all the rest. Jesus will have a second advent in which he comes back to this earth and he sets up his kingdom here, rules and reigns for 1,000 years. So we're in it. We're waiting for him to come back. But at that point, nobody knew that this was even going to be a thing, let alone what it was like. And so Jesus explaining to them what that interim period is going to be like, the kingdom of heaven, the mystery of that gap, that interim period. He goes, this is what you can expect in the church age. So Jesus is using parables to describe that. And he's using parables to make sure that those to whom these mysteries have been given would actually comprehend them, while those to whom it has not been given would miss the point. I think that's an interesting reality about the Messiah that we believe in, that he would actually teach in such a way that it would go over the heads of some people, many people, most people. He's going to explain now to his disciples this kingdom of heaven while obscuring it from the rest of the multitudes. So very few people are going to understand this. Most will not. And the disciples did understand. I think that we have evidence as things go along in the Gospels to suggest that they were starting to comprehend as time went along. By the end of Matthew in chapter 24, Jesus is explaining to them what it's going to be like in the last days at the return of Christ after that gap is over. And he says, they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds with power and glory. Angels will announce it with a loud shout and all the rest. And then he goes on and says, but nobody knows when that's going to happen. Nobody knows the day. Nobody knows the hour. Because obviously his disciples would have been wondering, well, how long is this interim period? They had no idea. Then you remember how after Jesus died and came back to life, he was out and about for about 40 days. And he met with his disciples. And in Acts chapter 1, verse 6, his disciples were there talking to Jesus. And of course, at that point, they must have been remembering what Christ had taught about that mysterious gap in between his first arrival and his second arrival. Because they said to him, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? Like, is that interim period over? Like all that stuff you're talking about, the kingdom of heaven is like. Remember the parables? Yes. Well, you were gone for like 40 days plus three. So are you going to restore the kingdom? Are we going to set up our throne? Are we going to rule and reign with you now? Is it done? Are we there? So they understood the mystery. They knew that there would be a gap between Jesus' first arrival and a second. They just didn't know how long that gap would be. And you know what Jesus said to them in response? It's not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father has put in his own authority. He goes, you don't know and I don't know. Only God knows how long that'll be. And then you know what Jesus did after he said that? He bolted up into the clouds, floated away. That began the interim period. And it's still going. Even from the early days of the church, you can see that they're still coming to grips with this idea that the king has gone away. 1 Thessalonians 5:1, Paul writes to that church and says, brothers and sisters, about times and dates, we don't need to write to you. Okay? The church was freaked out that maybe Jesus had already come back and they missed it, or the timing was all messed up. And Paul writes and puts them at ease saying, it hasn't happened yet. Perhaps the Holy Spirit through Paul was kind of saying, it ain't going to happen for a while. 2,000 years later, we can attest to the fact that it isn't going to happen for a while, right? Could happen at any time, but we don't know. Nobody knows except for God. And so it's interesting to just see how the church has reacted to these mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. And it's obvious that it still to this day goes over a lot of people's heads, that there's going to be a gap here and nobody knows how long that gap is going to last. Because I don't know if you've ever been really paying attention, but there's a lot of people out there that try and predict the end of the world and they try and predict the return of Christ and they keep getting it wrong. You ever notice that? There was a man named Hippolytus. Yeah. You're thinking of having more kids. You might want to consider that one. It's a great name. Hippolytus of Rome. That's what they used to name their kids back then, you know, in Rome anyway. But this was in 500 AD. He predicted that Jesus would come back at that time. He predicted it would be at 500 AD because he was taking that somehow he had taken into consideration the dimensions of Noah's Ark and came up with 500 AD. And word spread that Jesus was going to come back in five, and then You know, he didn't. Pope Sylvester. Any Catholics in here? You know, I don't know, Pope Sylvester? That guy. He believed that Jesus was going to come back in 1000 AD. Okay, and there was some in between, but I'm not hitting them all. A guy named Michael Stifel, he's a mathematician if you care. He did some calculations and determined that Judgment Day would happen at 8 in the morning on October 19th, 1533. And it didn't. Richard Brothers was a retired sailor. He predicted that in 1793 Jesus would come back, which again, Jesus didn't. Richard Brothers ended up in being committed to an insane asylum. Joanna Southcott, I threw her in here because she was a 64-year-old self-decided prophetess. She just told everybody that she was a prophet. She claimed to be pregnant with Christ, who would be born, guess what, December 25th, 1814. And so that didn't happen. She died, and they did an autopsy and found that she was never pregnant in the first place. So, and boy, this continues to this day. You do a little research. There are already prophecies for, I think, 2024, 2029, 2057, just a few years coming up. I mean, you remember Y2K, don't you remember Y2K? Oh, the end, you know. And then there was the Mayan calendar because everybody realized the Mayans were the smartest people ever, only to find out that they were actually pretty stupid because they got that one wrong too. Harold Camping, that name ring a bell? His was May 21st of 2000, I think, 12. And the only reason I remember that is because I had a couple in the church that was getting married on that day, and they were praying really hard that Jesus wouldn't come back. So, but anyway, back to Matthew here. Jesus is revealing these mysteries to a select few, and it's obvious that even to this day, many are in the dark about this, but he's revealing it to these guys in code. It's cryptic. I find it interesting that there are so many people today that believe that Jesus simplified his teaching and spoke in parables so that more people could understand, when actually the opposite is true. He spoke in parables so that less people, fewer of them, would understand. He didn't teach like this to help them understand what he was trying to communicate. He taught like this to keep them from understanding. And it begs the question, is that even fair? Like, sometimes I think it's all right to just take a look at Scripture for what it says and go, is God fair? Is that fair to people? And if that bothers you that I would even suggest that from the pulpit, you do it. Ain't anybody walk the face of this earth that's like, I agree with God 100% of the time. Everything that he allows in my life, I just embrace it and I thank him. No, we all are guilty of going, what? So why is it that some people get to understand this stuff and other people don't? Because Jesus just said that he teaches people like that because God has decided to let some people get it and not others. Seems rather flippant, especially when we look at God as such an evangelistic being. Doesn't the Bible say that he doesn't want anyone to perish, that it's his will that all be saved, you know, and everybody come to the knowledge of the truth and repent and be baptized? You know? So what's up with this? Well, Jesus says, in them the prophecy of Isaiah is fulfilled, which says, verse 14, hearing you will hear and won't understand, and seeing you will see and not perceive, for the hearts of this people have grown dull, their ears are hard of hearing, and their eyes they have closed, lest they should hear with their ears, lest they should understand with their hearts and turn, so that I could heal them. Jesus is giving us the reason here. The reason he kept most people in the dark is because their eyes they have closed. They closed their eyes. They don't want the truth. They already proved that they don't want the truth. And when it says lest, if your version says lest, their eyes they have closed, lest they should see with their ears, the word lest there means so as to prevent any possibility that they would hear with their ears, to prevent any possibility whatsoever that they would see with their eyes. They closed them themselves so that it prevents any possibility that they would understand and turn and be forgiven. So this wasn't God's fault at all. This was their fault. Jesus came preaching a message of repentance. They plugged their ears to it. And since they did, God wouldn't let them go any further in their understanding than what they already heard and knew. You were supposed to repent. You're not going to go any further in your life or understanding until you do. And did you know that he's playing the same game with people today? That if Jesus demands that you repent of sin and put your faith in Christ and you drag your feet and you draw a line and you know what you're supposed to do, but you won't do it and you won't respond and you won't embrace the truth you've already been given, then God folds his arms like this and gives you no more. In fact, it says that even what you might have had will be taken away from you. William MacDonald commentary, he says, it wasn't a matter of whim on the Lord's part, but simply the outworking of a principle which is built into all of life. Willful blindness is followed by judicial blindness. You want to close your eyes? You're welcome to do that. You want to plug your ears? Go right ahead. You want to harden your heart to what you know is true about God because you don't want your life to change and you're freaked out what will happen if you do? Jesus will allow that, but that deliberate blindness that you are demonstrating will be met with judicial blindness, just like it was for Pharaoh. If you remember the Old Testament story in the book of Exodus, the more Pharaoh hardened his own heart to the message that God gave through Moses, the more God confirmed his decision by hardening his heart for him. You can read. Happens, I don't know, a dozen times. Pharaoh hardened his heart. Happens several times. And then all of a sudden it starts saying, God hardened Pharaoh's heart. Because Pharaoh had already proven that he doesn't want the truth. And the same is true today. Again, I'm telling you, if the Christian life is unsatisfying, and maybe even the Bible is still to you unintelligible, like it just goes over your head, maybe it's just a book of riddles, that might be because a person is still to this day unrepentant. He had already tried to reach you where you were at in sin, that you might come to him in faith and be forgiven, but you still haven't done that. You've gotten religious. You still read your Bible. You know it. And you know, you come to church, and you know, there's a little bit of good in your life to kind of apply the salve to your guilty conscience and help you manage. But you haven't come to him in faith. You haven't repented of sins. And your level of understanding, just like it did for them, depends upon your recognition of Christ as Lord. Like he has the authority to change your life. He has the authority to tell you how to live it. And it's your responsibility then to respond to him in obedience. So that answers the question. Why did Jesus teach them like this? Well, according to Jesus, it was because they weren't listening anyway. And I'll tell you this, goes for everybody here. The best way to make the truth of Scripture continually alive and vibrant in your life is to continually respond to it. As soon as you stop, you'll get bored here. Guaranteed. But when you're out there in the trenches and you're applying the things that God has told you, everything keeps you awake. Everything keeps you wide awake in the kingdom of God. Serving him, fighting the fight. So Jesus says, that's why I'm doing it. Because they're not listening anyway. Now that's Jesus' answer for why he was starting to teach them in parables. But Matthew actually gives an answer of his own. I want you to look ahead to verse 34. We'll cover that briefly too. All these things Jesus spoke to the multitudes in parables, and without a parable, he didn't speak to them. Why? Verse 35 tells us, so that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, I will open my mouth in parables. I will utter things kept secret from the foundation of the world. So according to Jesus, the reason he was speaking in parables was to keep people from understanding while still educating those who appreciated the truth. Matthew inserts this reason. Jesus taught in parables to fulfill Scripture. Matthew's very interested in letting his audience know that Jesus fulfilled Scripture. Over and over again, Matthew says this. It's a fulfillment of a prophecy that was written in Psalm 78, which, by the way, the next time we go through Psalms on a Wednesday, it'll be Psalm 78, so there's a little bit of a teaser trailer, I guess. Psalm 78 was written by Asaph, and so if you needed further proof that Asaph was indeed a prophet, verse 35 indicates that. But for the disciples here, if there had been any residual concern that Jesus was kind of going in the wrong direction with his new teaching style, the fact that it was being done in fulfillment of prophecy would, I think, help put some of those concerns to rest. And so Matthew brings that point to light here for them. And if after all of that there still happened to be any doubt in his disciples that parables weren't the way to go, you know, if they still kind of wondered whether it was actually necessary to use that approach and, you know, whether people had really grown that hard-hearted to the truth, or whether they were, you know, able to stomach straightforward teaching anymore, Jesus is going to prove to them once and for all that people have actually closed their eyes. And so what he does is Jesus takes his disciples now to the one place in Israel, the one place in the entire country where you would assume that Jesus would get the warmest reception and the friendliest welcome. And Jesus is going to take his disciples now to Nazareth, a quaint little village where Jesus grew up. This is where his family lived. This is the community where people were most familiar with him. Okay, so you'd assume, certainly, most certainly, these people would still accept him, right? These people most certainly still appreciated the truth, right? They wouldn't need him to teach in parables, right? I mean, they could handle the straightforward, bold, clear, controversial teaching that Jesus was known for, right? So, what does Jesus do? Turn to verse 53. It came to pass when Jesus had finished these parables that he departed from there. And when he had come to his own country, he taught them in their synagogues, this is Nazareth, so that they were astonished. They were shocked. And they said, where did this man get this wisdom and these mighty works? Isn't this the carpenter's son? Isn't this Joe's kid? Isn't his mother Mary, right? And his brothers, James, Joseph, Simon, Judas, and his sisters, right? Aren't they all here? Where then did this man get all these things? So they were offended at him. But Jesus said to them, a prophet isn't without honor except in his own country, in his own house. And he didn't do many mighty works there because of their unbelief. I'm going to tell you right now that Jesus wasn't teaching in parables when he visited Nazareth. And we know that because if you'd like to turn to Luke chapter 4, Luke gives us a little bit more insight into this. Mark 6 tells us that his disciples were indeed with him, because Matthew didn't point that out. Luke 4, starting in verse 16, tells us what exactly it was that he taught them in the synagogue. Okay, so this is the same account, different author. In verse 16, it says, he came to Nazareth, where he'd been brought up, and as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up to read. And he was handed the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. Then he closed the book and he gave it back to the attendant and sat down. And the eyes of all who were in the synagogue were fixed on him. And he began to say to them, today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. So Jesus is going, I'm him. I'm the fulfillment of Isaiah. So all bore witness to him and marveled at the gracious words which proceeded out of his mouth. And they said, isn't this Joseph's son? And he said to them, you're going to surely say to me this proverb, physician, heal yourself. He's going, I already know your hearts. You've rejected me. You're going to taunt me. Physician, heal yourself. whatever we've heard done in Capernaum, do that here. And he said, now he's saying this to the church. This is not kind words for a church service. Assuredly, I say to you, no prophet is accepted in his own country. He says, but I tell you, many widows were in Israel in the days of Elijah, when the heavens were shut up for 3.5 years, and there was a great famine throughout all the land, and to none of them was Elijah sent except to Zarephath in the region of Sidon, a Gentile region, to a woman who was a widow. He goes, there's never been any faith around here. None of you ever believe in God. Isn't that a nice Christmas message? He goes, you ever read your Bible? You ever read that part about Elijah when he went to the widow at Zarephath? Do you ever put two and two together that she was a Gentile and that God sent Elijah to her to save her life because there was no widows in Israel? There was no Jewish women that actually believed in God back then? And then he says in verse 27, and many lepers were in Israel in the time of Elijah, the prophet, and none of them was cleansed except Naaman, the Syrian, long-standing enemies of the Jewish people. And he says, Naaman had faith, but none of the Jews did. Now, if you don't, you're not able to pick up on how offensive this was. Verse 28 helps. So all those in the synagogue, when they heard these things, they were filled with wrath. That means wrath. And they rose up and thrust him out of the city, and they led him to the brow of a hill on which their city was built, that they might throw him over the cliff. So this is attempted homicide, okay? His friends and his family, all his old neighbors, everybody that you would have thought would have given him a warm reception, attempted homicide after one sermon. And passing through the midst of them, he went on his way. Just so you know, what Jesus taught in the synagogue that day wasn't a parable. He had actually reverted to his old teaching method, clear, bold, controversial. And once again, it was rejected. And so now the disciples that had tagged along with him can see for themselves why parables were needed. Because people do shut their eyes to the truth. All you got to do is dig a little bit on them and you'll see how hostile they are. They only want you to leave them alone. That's why they borrow the Christian religion, so that they can hide behind it. Jesus' spirit is real and he speaks to people, and that includes you. And he has spoken to you, but I don't know whether you've responded or not. If you haven't, you're still in the dark and you need to repent. Let me be very clear this Christmas morning, because the light just might dawn in some of you. If you have not repented of your sin and unbelief, and you have not admitted to God that you hated him all your life, and you've rejected him, and this is not a love relationship with Jesus, this is one of hatred and rejection and denial and refusal, and your spit has landed on the proverbial face of Christ, and you have crucified him all over again, and you have put him to open shame, then you are still in the dark and have not gone one step further in the direction of biblical understanding. And this is why everything still to this day is boring to you and goes over your head. And if it weren't for a miraculous getaway in Luke chapter 4, Jesus would have died prematurely. But he wouldn't let that happen. He got away because he needed to die in sync with prophecy so that he could leave you and me and the entire human race with the atonement that we needed. So he did. He did. And that's the story behind the stories. But the same holds true even today. And I know it's Christmas, but there may be some who they don't even understand the truth of God and the coming of Christ, apart from a few things they heard around Christmas time. Oh, and that and Easter. And there are so many people who will not understand this because they are stubborn. They close their eyes. And it's always more comfortable to close your eyes when you're in the presence of a great threat, right? Because if you're really clever, you can convince yourself that it's not there. I can't see you. I can't see you. Like children hiding under the blankets. I'm safe here because I can't see what's out there. And nothing could be further from the truth. You have actually placed yourself in greater danger by comforting yourself with closed eyes. Open them up, stare the truth in the face, and admit that you need Christ's forgiveness. Jesus says, it's been given to you to know the mysteries, He was speaking to just a few. And if history repeats itself, and has over the last 2,000 years, there are a few who understand, who know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. And by the way, the word know there is gnosko. It's a familiar word to us around here because it means knowledge that's gained by experience. And Jesus goes, it's been given to you to not only hear this in parabolic form, but to apply this to your life and live by kingdom principles, that you would deepen your understanding by experiencing everything that's in the Bible as you live it out in your life. So I ask you this morning, do you know the mysteries of the kingdom that seem to elude so many other people? I'm not asking if you know your Bible. I'm not asking if you know that Jesus died for your sins and rose again 3 days later. We all get that. I'm asking you whether you truly know how this works. Do you know how this works? Anyone can hear the truth of Christ and the parables of God's kingdom, but only the true disciple can understand, because the disciple unites what they hear with how they live. And the average hearer refuses to do that. It's always been that way. The multitudes are still clueless. Jesus speaks to his disciples in a way that they can understand. So what's your story this morning? Are you being responsible with the truth you've been given? Have you ever responded to the truth to begin with? Because nobody, no one in this room is going to stay for the rest of their life where they're at right now. You are going to move forward, or you are going to move backward. And this is true of everyone, whether they're a Christian or not. You will move forward or backward. And just so that we're clear, please understand that God will supply every single person on the planet with enough truth to either swallow or spit out. God has supplied you with enough truth to either swallow or spit out. What have you done with it? Jesus came once, first Advent, right? We all know that, right? Merry Christmas. But he will return. He's going to come back. And nobody but God knows when he's coming back, which I believe is maybe the last mystery that there actually is. That's the one thing that God says, I ain't telling. It's indicated in Scripture that he wouldn't even tell Jesus. So Jesus is in the dark. He didn't know. He's just suddenly going to get the call from God the Father. It's time. And he's going to go, let's go. Where's my horse? Right? And he's going to come back. When? Don't bother trying to figure that out. Concern yourself with responding to the truth that you do have, not the truth you don't have. Respond to God with the truth the Holy Spirit has imparted to you. When that day comes, will you be ready? Don't close your eyes. Don't plug your ears. If you are a disciple this morning and you are being given more and more truth and you are moving forward, remember what Paul wrote in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 8. He says, at one time you were in darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. So, walk as children of light. For the fruit of light is found in all that is good and right and true. And try to discern what is pleasing to the Lord. That's our job. What has he given you this morning? What truth do you have? Embrace it, ingest it, incorporate it into your life. Keep going, and he will give you more and more and more. Don't draw lines in the sand. Father, this morning, I would pray on behalf of anybody in here who still might be responsible for dulling their heart to you and to what the Holy Spirit has communicated. If there's anybody in here who's responsible for closing their eyes or plugging their ears to the truth, I ask for forgiveness. That would include me. If I've drawn a line in the sand, if anybody in here has kind of said, God, I've gone far enough, I don't want any more, forgive us. Provide us with greater truth, Lord, that we might ingest it and continue on forward. I pray that we would repent in this church of our tendency, and maybe we're not doing this, but it is a tendency, I do believe, to plug our ears to what the Spirit is saying, close our eyes to what we're being shown in the Word. I pray this morning that we would soften beneath the patience that you demonstrate toward us and the compassion that you obviously have for us, and that we would respond, Lord, with the message that we've been given, and that we would do it with repentance. Let us always be marked by repentance. May it also be done with gladness, not begrudgingly, but with gratitude and with praise. And with that, Lord, we stand one more time to sing to you on your birthday.